Yeah, thank you. That's a, it's a good and obviously difficult question. I just wanted to, as we are talking about the United States of Europe or the lack thereof, I wanted first of all just to make one observation following on what Charles said on the fact in drawing a comparison with the US states and the fact that they had to balance their budgets. The problem we have in Europe is that European states, unlike US states, are responsible and have been responsible for their banking systems. And that, of course, is a huge difference. You don't ask the Dakotas to be responsible for the local banks that have been resident in their, locally. And we've seen countries like Spain entering the crisis in 2007 and 8 in a fairly strong fiscal position, precisely unlike others who are now better rated. And that is because what happened there was, in the case of Spain, for instance, was the level of private debt was a major concern, not so much the level of public debt. And so, you know, and Spain was individually responsible for the Spanish banks. And I think this is an issue that will have to be addressed before we can talk of a significant improvement in the way the Eurozone operates. Should we keep the individual states responsible for the, their individual banking sectors, or should we think of a system that is much like what prevails in the US, where there is a much more of a federal guarantee for the banking sector? And I think that's a question that has to be addressed as part of the way forward. The reason I'm saying this, and I'm not trying to escape the question that was asked to me, but it's just that to answer the question of how do you reduce debt, you need to, first of all, agree on who is responsible for what in that debt and in the debt reduction. If you ask individual countries alone, and I'm focusing on the Eurozone here, obviously, to be fully responsible for the debt reduction in their country, the private sector, the public sector alone, I don't think that's going to work. I think that's going to be a very difficult task, almost impossible. So there's got to be some kind of mutualization of parts of the debt. I mean, there's a remarkable report that just was published a week ago by the McKinsey Global Institute of Research, the Research Institute, and they show that deleveraging of the private sector in the U.S. is far more advanced at this point than it is in Europe. And they have wonderful, as always with McKinsey, they have wonderful charts, and you know, it's really very impressive. And it's, and of course they say, well, look, I mean, it's working in the US, it's not working in Europe. And I think this is a bit of an unfair trial in a sense, because of course, well, one of the reasons why it's more advanced in the US is there's been much more, many more defaults in the private sector in the US than in Europe. I'm not sure this is exactly what you want to see immediately happening in Europe, that, you know. But more fundamentally, if there was to be some defaults of a larger scale in the private sector in Europe, who would eventually be responsible and take the hit is something that has not been decided yet. And you're trying to push the envelope around, if you want, in a way that at some point, it's like the musical chair, you know, at some point the music stops, and that's when people hang up and realize there's not enough chairs.
Okay, thank you. Before we move to Q&A session, I think it's worth having a sort of 2-minute statement of each panelist, or what agreed, disagreed, and Personally, I would like to understand where are we going, what sort of growth model on aggregate level we'll see. In the past 10, 20 years, we saw a rapid expansion of financial system, rising debt, and that what inflated domestic demand in the developed countries, and developing countries responded, and economic growth was strong. Debt, it's a problem now. How will get out of this situation?
Yeah, let me say, first of all, I agreed with almost everything that was said by the rest of the panel, but I think even as someone who was a political leader, it's difficult for us to blame the people when things go wrong. I think we've got to accept responsibilities as leaders. I'm also reminded of George Bernard Shaw, who was a famous British poet, who used as an excuse when his opening night of his show in a theatre like this went wrong. He said, the show was excellent, but the audience was poor. And it is very easy to say that we should re-elect the electorate when things go wrong rather than re-elect the politicians. I think we've got to accept responsibility. There has been a failure of leadership in the world community, and there still is, because these are global problems that can be solved by action in coordination. I think we're forgetting, really, that if you look at the global economy as a whole, and this is answering your question about what are the trends for the future, the biggest issue is this, that for the last 30 years and more, the American consumer has driven forward the global economy. You could say it's the Western consumer, America and Europe, driven the world economy forward, latterly because of an expansion of debt, but generally because of the huge productivity of the American labor force. In the next 10 years, you will see the Asian consumer driving the world economy forward, but perhaps not significantly to create global growth to the extent we need until the 2020s. So you have a 10-year transition, while the American consumer, the Western consumer, will not spend a huge amount more, but equally the Asian consumer, the Chinese consumer in particular, is not wealthy enough to drive the world economy forward yet. And we've got to look at what are the policies for growth that will happen in the transition and how we can create higher levels of global growth than we have at the moment. And I was suggesting yesterday that we've got to look at how we can expand infrastructure and other things that will make this world economy move a bit faster. As far as the euro is concerned, I think the fascination of this discussion is that we all know that if the euro is going to be capable of creating growth in the euro area, there will have to be quite fundamental structural change in Europe. I have got to tell you what happened in Britain, because I was one of the people who recommended we did not join the euro. And we had to make a very big decision in the wake of a massive public opinion amongst experts and economists and others who at that time thought the only way forward for Britain was to be part of the euro experiment. And we didn't join for very good reasons. We could not see a way that Britain could survive and converge properly in the European Union under the current arrangements. And we did not think the euro had any crisis prevention mechanism, or for that matter, any crisis resolution mechanism. And obviously that has been the problem that has made it difficult for the euro area to escape from this crisis. But I do think there is far more popular support for staying within the euro than people imagine. If you look at the polling that is done in Greece and in Spain and in Portugal, the three countries that are most likely to want to leave the euro because of the terms and conditions that are being imposed upon them, then I would say between 70 and 80% of the public want to be part of the euro. The real problem is in Germany, where 75% of the German public would prefer to throw Greece out of the euro. And that is a real difficulty that I think we face. And I would come back in the euro area, not simply to the problems that have already been mentioned, but it is very difficult to run a successful economic union when the standard of living or income per capita of the poorest member of that euro area, the poorest state, is only 25% of that of the richest state. And something has got to give over a period of time. Either that state has got to show it can raise its standards of living substantially through its productivity and everything else, or there has got to be, as in the United States of America, as in Britain, where we've got a union of Scotland, England, Northern Ireland and Wales, there's got to be resources that are provided to enable these inequalities to be bridged. So there are fundamental issues in the European Union about the inequalities between different member states in the European Union, as well as the points that I've made about structural reform, the need for growth, banking reform, which of course is urgently needed, as well as fiscal consolidation. And I think we've got to be pretty honest that this was a union that was created without thinking about all the problems that could arise because of the creation of that union.
Thank you. I think we are doing a great show, and to check whether the audience is equally great, we need some time for Q&A, and there is a reminder. Not yet, maybe up to one minute, final statement from each participant, and before we move to...
Okay, it's hard to summarize in 1 minute a very difficult debate. Let me go to back to the European construction. I agree with Ken when he says the European Constitution is unsustainable. I would say that every new historical construction is unsustainable at the beginning and has to be improved over time. This is a historical change. It's barely 12 years since we started the euro. We discover the limits of the construction. Actually, many of these limits have been described abundantly in the literature, and the politicians didn't want to look at it. They wanted to bake with the success of the construction rather than face the weaknesses. I don't think the problems are fatal, and I very much agree with what Gordon Brown said. What was missing was a crisis resolution mechanism. And the reason was because there was to be no crisis when it's been constructed. And when the crisis occurred, policymakers found themselves without any pre-thought solution, and they basically went in the wrong direction at the wrong time. But it's almost predictable. That doesn't mean that the construction is fraud. That doesn't mean that there is one model. And when I hear things about comparing Europe to either the United Kingdom or to the United States, these are not valid comparisons. It's a completely different construction with sovereign states, which have some sense of commonality, but a much more limited sense of commonality than you find within the US or the UK, which are nations under one king or under one god. That's not Europe, and we are trying to chart a different way of dealing with that. I think we are on the right track, but we are not there. That I fully agree about.
Okay. Thank you. 1 minute. Final statement.
Well, I think if we step back and look at the underlying growth in the global economy, there's a theme which is Bill White laid out in a very forceful way. But a lot of debt out there still. A lot of the problems that led to the 2008 crisis are ameliorated because there's been a very forceful monetary response, particularly this quantitative easing, first in the United States, now in Europe, which I know is not necessarily very popular in Russia, but probably was a necessary step in both places. But there, in order to have growth, which the Prime Minister Gordon Brown very forcefully said at the outset, and you have to have, it really is going to have to come with structural reforms that these countries, these regions have not wanted to face. And you can look at the United States, you can look at Japan, you can look at Europe. And if you don't have that, I think these debt problems will get worse and not get better. And so I like to believe that in the face of such risks, such clear dangers, we will see dramatic changes, but I suspect there'll be some countries, regions, where it doesn't happen quickly enough, and we could still see problems ahead.
Thank you. Mr. White.